Because both the ANC and the DA make the mistake of thinking that you can address these questions by intervening superficially, by enriching a few people. This is a deep-seated problem, Judge.
He wasn't saying that.
Well, but their idea, neoliberal ideological positions say that you must do enterprise.
Don't say slogan. I'm talking what he just said now. I'm talking what he said now.
Yeah.
He said, and if I've got him wrong, then tell me why.
Sure.
But I understood him to be saying that there was a real need for redress in communities. You had to build communities.
Yeah.
You had to, well, you had to accept that.
No, but I mean that
in the black areas.
No,
he was talking
that's
about.
Meaningless. Everyone says there must be redress. The question is, how do you do the redress? Right. And that's
now
exactly
you
where we
to do it.
I'm saying you can only do the well. Don't put words in my mouth. You can only redress. You can only redress by addressing the conditions of the weakest among us, of those people that I spoke about, who do not know what they're going to eat
And are you
tonight.
Suggesting that they haven't done that?
You can't do that by empowering a few people and making them billionaires and hoping that by some magic it's going to trickle down to the lowest. You must unashamedly and without making any excuses intervene on behalf of the weak.
Decisive intervention.
Decisive intervention. Right. They say, let me just give you one cold
statistic. No, finally, you've got to finish. I've got to take a break and give the minister a chance.
Okay. One cold statistic. Yeah. The NDP, which they believe in, says that 40% of the lowest people only enjoy 6% of the economy. Yeah. Those people are black and African. Yeah. But they say in 2030, you must increase that 6% to 10%. In other words, you must maintain the inequality, but just
no,
little
they're saying it takes time to deal with it. And maybe they're not promising that which they can't deliver. And they accuse your party of promising that which can never be delivered.
No, they can't deliver it because on their own statistics, it must only happen when there's 5.4% growth, which will never happen. It's a pipe dream.
Yeah. I'm going to give the minister an opportunity, but I must take a break and then I'll come back to him and to Mr. Singh. His argument.
You know, Mr. Mpofu reminds me of a revolutionary who appears to be very revolutionary, but is not, except espousing insurrectionary phrase mongering. And I think to refer to the EFF as left, it's a pick and choose party. You know, they pick and choose party. Yeah, they pick on something that they think that resonates with the poor, and then they run with it. And that does not define the ideology of the party, but is for another discussion. The ANC, when it seeks to intervene in relation to addressing the needs of historically disadvantaged, it's not picking on black billionaires and making them fat cats. It is a holistic policy.
But the accusation is
First and foremost, it's a holistic policy that for a very short space of time, he has already forgotten. That policy was basically meant to intervene in terms of uplifting our people who were historically disadvantaged to also participate in mainstream economy.
But has it not been a top-down?
No. The fundamental question in relation to that particular policy is that it has actually produced the results, no matter how they could actually be criticized.
But our Gini coefficient, which measures inequality, is worse than ever.
The fact of the matter is that you can't therefore say when you apply affirmative action and when you apply BBB, it is about an intervention of just a quarter of the few. That is not correct to suggest because
how does it benefit the poor?
Exactly what it is.
Mr. Singh,
that's exactly what it is. I mean, even the majority black people are very, very critical of BEE and BBBE because they themselves are saying, it's not us, it's they themselves who are saying that a quarter of people are benefiting from BEE. Mm. So where's this massive economic empowerment and political
impetus? The
fact of the matter is that BE on its own, it doesn't run on its own. It is also about an emphasis on the investment of the upliftment of small, medium, macro enterprise, because that is fundamentally important. And in this particular instance, where you basically have got 2% of the economy in the hands of the few, so to say, and at the same time, you can't basically talk about locking out the historically disadvantaged. Fundamentally,
don't we need
those who are basically empowered in terms of the economy does not mean that in themselves It is locked into them, but it is about uplifting the disadvantage.
Mr. Mamoni, you wanted to make a point?
The fact of the matter is that as BEE has been implemented in the last 20 years, it hasn't delivered the results we want. Let's just face those facts. Let's also accept the fact that it's delivered a society that others are included and others are excluded out of it. Let's just be frank about this issue. And the other exacerbating factor is that as our economic growth is starting to slag behind at the levels that they are, it means the prospect of broadening the inclusion levels, in fact, begin to diminish. And our fundamental argument is that you've got to start, in fact, as the Millennial Development Goals would argue, to say that you've got to increase your economic output at a particular level so that you can absorb higher levels of employment.
But you're accused of also adhering to neoliberal policies, which actually
and
also
I want to respond
down.
To that.
But yes, I want to. I want to respond now because then when I have
yes, I want to respond to this.
We'll respond
issue.
Right now.
If we talk about a market-driven economy,
yes,
because when you use terms like neoliberal, you start to make them seem like swear words. Let's talk about markets. Let's talk about the fact that the dream for South Africans, and we'll talk about reconciliation, is that people must stand up and say, I own my own business. I can grow it. I can, in fact, make sure it provides for more people. And surely that is an ambition across all races in South Africa. And my view standing here today is that when we grow the economy, we allow more small businesses to thrive, we'll have more South Africans, black South Africans, being included in the economy.
What's wrong with that vision?
No, it's absolute nonsense.
Why?
You can't have change or remember what we're talking about here is non-racialism.
Yes.
And my thesis is simply this, that you are not going to have a non-racial society if you do not address the economic inequalities which underlie the problem of apartheid.
The only question
we're
debating is then how to do so, yes?
No, but to respond directly to what Moose is saying, the difference between us and the neoliberals, whether they're ANC or DA, is that they think that this can be done from a top-down. The solution will come from a top-down. In other words, you enrich or co-opt a few black people into the middle class.
I don't think that's what they
well,
say.
But that's exactly what has happened. What has happened is that the people at the bottom have not smelt the freedom because they've been neglected.
Have there
a
not
few
been
more
houses, electricity, and all sorts of things built? I mean,
well,
are we not ignore
well,
that?
There are mud houses, there are mud schools, as I'm speaking to you now. There are bucket people who do not have toilets, as I'm speaking to you now. And then there are people who are billionaires who have been created by the current system. Now, if you think that is going to change the racial inequality, then that's a
okay. pipe. But Advocate Mpofu knows very well, and this is an important point, that by saying let the state own everything, it isn't going to address this particular issue.
Yeah, I'd love to
that this notion of saying that let... You know this idea that it's by the people cannot be replaced by the government.
No, that's an easy one. It's another this notion
that... But that is your policy.
It is our policy, but this notion that what was created by state intervention over 300 years, as you've put it, is now suddenly going to be undone by wishful thinking and the invisible hand of Adam Smith is the absolute
but that
nonsense.
Isn't what anybody
it's
said.
Not going to happen. State intervention caused the problem. State ownership and redistribution is also going. There's no economy. In the US, which is supposed to be so-called free market, what happened when the crisis came? They nationalized the banks. They might call it bailouts or whatever. It was nationalization.
Yes, but they still kept
that's
them.
That's what it was. Yeah.
But all right. But can I just ask you?
It's a question of equity participation.
Yes.
The majority of the people need to have equity participation.
Why we can't have non-racialism is because a vast percentage of our population are excluded.
That is true.
Right?
That's
you can't have a non-racial society, which
absolutely.
Is what everybody's telling you.
Yeah.
So how do you do it?
Well, equity participation in
what
state-owned enterprises. There's about 700 odd state-owned enterprises which exist out there. And many of them should not really exist. They are just taking taxpayers' money and putting it in their pocket. We're bailing them out ever so often. But look at companies, I won't mention their names on TV, but there are companies that offer shares. That offer shares to the ordinary man
but
in
you've
the street.
But you've got to reconstruct he's saying you've got to reconstruct the economy in order to get people to participate. Do you accept that?
Well, yes. Small
but
and medium enterprises
see,
need
I don't
to
understand.
Be
you're also
courage.
Saying that to some extent. I mean, I know you're having a great debate with Mr. Porfu, but the second transformation was
there is no negotiation about the question of the role of the state and state intervention. And that has taken form one way or the other in the past 20 years of freedom. All what we're talking about is to accelerate that. And the fact of the matter is that we don't agree with the notion that leave everything to the markets and the state have got no role to play. That is not...
Can I ask a second? I want to move off this because I'm running out of time. You made another point and I want to shift gear for a moment. You said we need to have a civilized discourse even if we can disagree with each other.
which is what I took you to mean, was black and white people would talk to each other and they wouldn't use the color of their skin, etc. They'd engage. Is that what
it's you... dialogue.
Yeah.
Because we need to continue to negotiate this path of talking and building bridges of dialogue. And I made a specific example, which you can only achieve with one game of rugby.
Mm.
But that argument and that sort of conversation is not there.
Do you accept that?
No, of course I accept, but the conversation must be between the haves and the have-nots. It's not necessarily between black and white. And this is not a matter of a rugby game.
But
it's about making sure that you go to the fundamentals and saying to the poor, what is your stake in this economy?
I accept that.
Because if they do not have a stake in the economy, then they will have no stake in stability.
I realize that. Judge, I'm talking...
The fact of the matter is that the South African economy, you've got two economies within one. That is the reality. And then you talk about development and growth and at the same time, and they have not. But the fundamental question is that those who don't have and they belong to the second economy. And then those who've got belong to the first economy that is white. That is where the DA draw their resources, draw their political mindset and ideology and direction of
why do you disagree?
I disagree fundamentally.
Why?
That's why here is a government that is in fact failed black South Africans. Here is a government led by the ANC that's allowed 1.5 million South Africans to be unemployed.
It's not.
It is. In the last 5 years, that's factually true. The discussion we ought to be having here.
Not by design, is that what he says.
It is by design. There are some policy decisions that the ANC have taken.
That economy at that particular time lost jobs. That has got nothing to do with the ANC government.
The ANC took policy decisions. For example, we haven't in fact even completed the study about what corruption has cost us in terms of economic growth.
I can't deal with that now.
But I want to conclude. We talk about racial integration, which is the fundamental question.
Which is what I'm trying to probe.
What my argument is, what should have been at the forefront of policy development is about how do we create small businesses, not to the exclusion of enterprises.
Right,
I want to conclude by saying.
You can conclude.
That racial South Africans who need to be able to stand up and be who they are in this country rather than be associated with a class on the basis of their race, that we've got to change.
Mr. Mpofu, I wanted to come back to where I started with the clip.
Right.
So your colleague and certain of the other people, white people, start screaming at each other. Oh. It's actually unhelpful.
Oh. No, absolutely.
I mean, how do we construct at least this? And I want to hold on to this, so at least we can talk through these questions.
Let me tell you, I think the solution is what, and I must give credit, because it's not an original idea, to General Bantu Olomisa, what he has called an economic CODESA. What is needed, you're quite right, is a conversation, a serious, frank, not a nice conversation about our history, about where the property relations were in 1994, where they are now, where the Gini coefficient is, where it was, what interventions are needed. And we don't have to be kissing and hugging each other. We must tell each other that white people were privileged by colonialism and apartheid. Black people were repressed by those things. 1913 Land Act, how do we reverse that? Because only once we do that, then will the people in the mines not feel that we are still in the same position as we were in 1995.
I accept that. I have to close, unfortunately. I'm sorry this is the last debate. I would like to carry on for another hour, but I can't. And it's a pity. But I do want to say that I think we should have you all back for further debates. There can't be any more single important question in this country as to how do we actually vindicate, how do we implement, how do we actually concretize a non-racial vision. One of the things that